Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Evam parampara praptam imang raja shayo viduhu. Sakale neha mahata yogo nashtaf parantapa. First translation. This supreme science was thus received through the chain of disciplic succession, and the saintly kings understood it in that way. But in course of time, the succession was broken, and therefore the science as it is appears to be lost. Purport. It is clearly stated that the Gita was especially meant for the saintly kings because they were to execute its purpose in ruling over the citizens. Certainly, Bhagavad Gita was never meant for the demonic persons who would dissipate its value for no one's benefit and would devise all types of interpretations according to personal whims. As soon as the original purpose was scattered by the motives of the unscrupulous commentators, there arose the need to re-establish the disciplic succession. 5,000 years ago, it was detected by the Lord himself that the disciplic succession was broken, and therefore he declared that the purpose of the Gita appeared to be lost. In the same way, at the present moment also, there are so many editions of the Gita, especially in English, but almost all of them are not according to authorized disciplic succession. There are innumerable interpretations rendered by different mundane scholars, but almost all of them do not accept the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Krishna, although they make a good business on the words of Sri Krishna. This spirit is demonic because demons do not believe in God but simply enjoy the property of the Supreme. Since there is a great need of an edition of the Gita in English as it is received by the Parampara, disciplic succession, system, an attempt is made herewith to fulfill this great want. Bhagavad Gita, accepted as it is a great boon to humanity, but if it is accepted as a treatise of philosophical speculations, it is simply a waste of time. This verse is very well known among followers of Srila Prabhupada, as it is a principle that he much emphasized, that knowledge has to be received through a bona fide parampara. Here the word parampara is used in a general sense in this verse, and it's often used in a specific sense as a synonym of sampradaya, specific parampara. So the parampara is to deliver spiritual knowledge. Often it's considered that that which is spiritual and that which is knowledge are not the same, because knowledge means something specific, and truth in the imagination of various species of Mayavadis is something non-specific. Recently it was brought to my attention again that Mahatattva Prabhu had last year given a short talk called A Guru as Truth Conductor. It just struck me that in English, when the word truth is used in the context of that which is spiritual, it has impersonal connotations. The truth, it's generally thought of as something beyond words, beyond normal experience, Whereas in the, well, in Shastra we have also the Krishna is described as Satyam Param, the Supreme Truth, that is specifically linked with the personality of Godhead. Srila Prabhupada often described Krishna as the Absolute Truth or the Supreme Absolute Truth. Here in Bhagavad Gita, Krishna speaks of Tattvagyan Artha Darshanam. Tattvagyan, this term, Tattva means categories and Jnana means knowledge. So this term is often used in Indian languages, in spiritual discourses or supposedly spiritual discourses, to mean philosophy, tattvagyan. But the guru is a conductor, yes, through the parampara, through the disciplic succession, a transmitter of the truth which is described. Rishibhir Bahuda Gitam Chandobhir Vivithai Pritak Brahma Sutra Padaish Chaiva Hetu Madhbhir Vineshchitai is described. The rishis in various ways they describe or they perceive. The Vedic mantras describe Chanda in also in various ways, but it's specifically ascertained in the Vedanta Sutra, that absolute truth. So it's described what that truth is. It's not simply something vague and impersonal, as Srila Prabhupada writes in an early purport in the Srimad Bhagavatam, the mythology of the guru touching the disciple and transmitting an electric shock so that the disciple faints to wake and see the guru. Well, Srila Prabhupada doesn't put the whole story in there, but he awakes to see the guru crying. And why are you crying? Because I gave everything I had to you by electric shock. This is, it's folk stories. Because spiritual knowledge, when given, or any knowledge for that matter, the person who gives it doesn't lose it. So this function of the guru is to transmit knowledge and experience. We find here in Bhagavad Gita also, Raja Vidya Raja Guhyam Pavitram Idam Uttamam Pratyakshavagamam Dharmyam Susukam Kartam Avyayam. This knowledge, which is conducted or distributed in parampara, it is the highest knowledge, the most secret of all secrets, the purest knowledge. It is to be factually perceived, directly perceived. It's not, when we say knowledge, it's not simply theoretical, but it's experiential also. So the guru does transmit the knowledge which enables us to experience the truth, who is Krishna. Even on the mundane platform, by learning and studying, one can come to appreciate better. For instance, a layman may look at some classical painting, or a layman may listen to some classical music, but someone who's been trained in studying fine art, or has been trained in hearing and understanding the subtleties of classical music, they will appreciate, even though they hear the same thing, the layman and the trained person, they hear the same thing, but the trained person can understand better. The skeptic may say, can you show me God? The answer is yes, but you can't see. You have to be trained to see. Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. Who opened our eyes? How? By Gyananjana. Opened our eyes by applying the cream of the medicine of knowledge, by which otherwise in any field, the scientist trained physicist, he can see, if we ask, what is the proof? Can you prove electrons exist? Can you prove God exists? Well, God's a big topic. Why don't we start with something much smaller? Just you prove, first of all, that electrons exist. So, show me electrons. Well, they're everywhere, but, well, I don't see them. God is everywhere. I don't see. So, but how will you see? Then you have to be trained. So you do the experiment, and you do the whole experiment. I still didn't see any electrons. But someone who's trained, they can understand that this experiment, it verifies the existence of electrons. So the eyes of spiritual knowledge are given by the guru. Of course, spiritual reality is not to be seen by simply mundane knowledge. It's not just a matter of studying, that one can study, but one has to be admitted. And it's also not just like being admitted as a doctor or a member of the Royal Society of Scientists or whatever. But one has to be admitted ultimately by Krishna, and Guru is the person who does the recommending. But it's a matter of consciousness, purification of consciousness, by which one can understand. One can understand, not everyone has the ability to understand the scientific formulae by which electrons can be recognized. So not everyone has the ability in this life to understand God, it may not be. But those who are to understand, they have to purify their consciousness. One can be a scientist and be a lecher and a tippler and all kinds of bad activities. But, of course, generally scientists aren't, because if you're going to be a scientist, you have to really concentrate on it. If you can do it seriously, it's not a hobby. It's true in spiritual life, it's true in any serious discipline, even in the mundane world. If you're going to get ahead and understand science, you have to apply yourself to it. You can't be a drunkard. So, in Krishna consciousness, to understand, purification of consciousness is required. So this amanitvan, adhambitvan, first thing, not to be proud. This is the first qualification of a disciple, to, as he's admitted into the school of transcendental knowledge, he first of all has to understand that he's not being admitted simply to learn knowledge. Jnane prayasam udapasya namanta eva. He has to learn to be humble. Humility is the entrance into discipleship. Humility, that's true in any discipline. If you want to study science also, if you come in the beginning and the professor says, now we're going to teach you whatever, calculus, mathematics, and he puts some squiggles on the board, and you say, well, what's this? It's just some funny drawings, like some primitive hieroglyphics or something. This is all nonsense. It is nonsense to you because you don't understand. So to you, it's nonsense. But if you're humble enough to admit that, I don't know, this person knows, if I open my mind and admit that I don't know, then I submissively hear from the teacher, then I can learn. So humility is the entrance to knowledge, but in the knowledge of Krishna consciousness, the science of Krishna consciousness, it's the entrance, it's the means, and it's the end also. It's not that one is humble as a disciple, learns everything and kills the guru. Guru Maravidya. Now I don't need a guru anymore, and no one else needs a guru, because I know everything in you, so there's no need of two of us. I'll be the guru. Guru Maravidya. Kill the guru. I'll be the guru. But humility is required. Always. Janme Janme Prabhu Se, not that I've learned everything, and now I don't need a guru, but the Chokudano Diloje, who gave me eyes to see, is my master, birth after birth. Humility is the precursor to, it doesn't work. Krishna consciousness doesn't work without that. Krishna Prem, what is this? Krishna Prem, to be sought for by chanting the holy names of Krishna, by Sankirtan. But what is the key? We are all chanting Hare Krishna. What is the formula? This OBL Kapoor, Adi Kesha Prabhu, once asked Abhay Charanaravinda Das, his godbrother, who is a pharmacist in Allahabad, that we're all chanting Hare Krishna, but we're not getting prem. What's the chemical formula? What's the formula? You know all different chemicals for relieving different conditions. What's the pharmaceutical formula for, speaking in a joking way, semi-joking way, what is the formula for getting prem? We know that by chanting, then prem should arise. And Srila Prabhupada said, yeah, I know the formula. But it's not everyone can take that. What is the formula? Chunada pisuni chena, tarori vasa hishnana, amanya, na amana dena kirtaniya sadahari. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu also says that, ki rupe nam loile, prema upajoy, taha lakon shuno shurup ramrai. Speaking to Srup Damodaran Ramananda Rai, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said that, now I'll tell you the how to chant the holy names in such a way that prem will arise. What are the characteristics? What is the means? And that's the answer. Trinadapi sunichena tarori vasahishna amanina amanadena kirtaniya sadahari. So the guru is to train the disciple in this humility, but it seems contradictory because he himself has to take a very high position. He has to take the position of spiritual master. Srila Prabhupada translated the word guru as spiritual master. Whereas in spiritual life, it means to become dasa dasa anudas. So it seems like a contradiction. This was addressed in a famous speech by Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, in which he said that if a Vaishnava becomes a guru, then he ceases to be a Vaishnava. Because a Vaishnava has to take a position of humble to everyone, lower than everyone. Jagai madhai hoite, mui se papishta. If you think, someone may think, I'm just a worm. That's humility. Purishera akit hoite, mui se logishta. But Krishna's Kaviraj said, I'm not a worm, I'm lower than a worm in stool. So that's real. He thinks like that. And it's not, I'm more sinful than Jagai and Madhai. And objectively speaking, Krishna's Kaviraj, he wasn't sinful, but like Jagai and Madhai, but he actually thinks like that. Srila Prabhupada explained in one lecture that he's not just writing that. Sometimes a devotee may say, well, I'm so fallen, but Krishna's Kaviraj really means it when he says that. He has so much humility. So this is the formula which the guru has to teach, and Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur therefore said that who claims to be a guru, he's not a Vaishnava. But on the other hand, if a Vaishnava doesn't become a guru, then the parampara stops. And he's ordered. The order comes in disciplic succession. Jare deko tare koha Krishna upadesh. So Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, in his inimitable way, explained that the symptom of humility of the guru, who doesn't appear to be humble, or might not appear to be humble, is that he accepts the order of his predecessor as his life. And therefore, he instructs others. So this is how this conundrum is solved. So the guru is a teacher, but not just a teacher in the formal academic sense. That is there also. but is to impart to the disciple a sense of service and surrender to Krishna. This principle of the guru comes in parampara. He just doesn't invent something and say, well, here I am, I'm self-realized, and you can all hear from me. That's non-verifiable. There's no checks and balances. The checks and guru, sadhu, shastra, there's the checks and balances system that we have to... What the guru speaks is in relationship or is directly from shastra and is confirmed by previous acharyas. He's not just making something up. It comes... just as Krishna spoke, Imang Vivasvate Yogang Proktavanahamabeyam Vivasvan Manabe Praho Manorikshvaka Vibravit. Just as Krishna spoke to the sun god, who spoke to Manu, who spoke to Ikshvaku, and the same message comes down. So, just 2 days ago, one devotee who had been reading Jaiva Dharma of Bhaktivinoda Thakur said, yes, I can see it's Prabhupada, he's just saying the same thing. He gets it all from Jaiva Dharma. Yes, and Bhaktivinoda, he gets it from the previous acharyas also. It's not that Bhaktivinoda Thakur made it all up and then Srila Prabhupada is saying the same thing. You look at the previous, it's all the same. It's the same message in generation after generation. So he may think, well, why... So, what do we need a guru for? Well, just the message is the same, a previous acharya is all the same, so just read all their writings and we'll get the message. But that's not the system given by Krishna. Personal guidance is required, and according to the particular circumstances in this world, there are always so many different philosophies floating around. We see that previous acharyas they dealt in great detail with various misconceptions that were prominent at the time. We will find that our acharyas have addressed the improper or wrong conclusion of shvotvad, for instance. Well, no one talks about that nowadays. Maybe some scholars. It was prominent at one time, some philosophy about it, ultimately impersonal, as usual. So, Srila Prabhupada, he preached so much against the speculations of Darwin. Well, no one, Vishwanath Chakravarti, he didn't speak about that. Well, why not? Because Darwin hadn't come and made his speculation. You have to address the particular ethos of illusion, the forms that Maya takes at any particular time. Now, Srila Prabhupada, he emphasized this principle of parampara again and again and again, and said that I am simply repeating what I've heard from my guru, and he enjoined his disciples to do. Also, he also said that, well, it's not just a matter of just learning like a parrot, but one has to understand and chitete korea aika, make it one with the heart, and represent that knowledge in a manner that is suitable for others to understand. But when Srila Prabhupada first came to the West, the principle of that he was a member of a parampara made no difference to the people he was speaking to. In India, nowadays not much, because modern Hinduism is dominated by guru worship. It's a major factor. Worship of Sai Baba and his Amma, and there's different appas and dadas and papas and all kinds of weird and nonsense. Now there's some Radha Ma who's being locked up for her improprieties. So it's just some personality cults. That's of much of what modern Hinduism is, but any traditional orthodox person, if there's still some left, they understand that to be a guru, one has to come in a bona fide accepted parampara. Of course, when we say bona fide accepted parampara, we have a much more narrow spectrum of acceptance, because there'll be also the things like the Kabir Pantha, all different kinds of paramparas. They have a parampara, but then who began it? If Kabir, some weaver from North India, just came up with his inspired speculations, and then coming from him, there are different followers, but that's not bona fide, because what is the source? The source is not Krishna. Bona fide paramparas, they begin with Krishna, and they're founded in Shastra. It's not acceptable to orthodox followers of the Vedic principles that one can simply invent something at one point in time and by the power of one's charisma establish a new disciplic succession. That's not acceptable. But practically that's what Srila Prabhupada had to do when he came to the West. It wasn't that, here I am, I'm a member of a parampara, I'm authorized to speak. Actually, that was the fact. But he won over followers. He won followers not because of his credentials, not specifically because of his credentials, but because of his personality. It was very much influential in bringing people to Krishna consciousness, which is why to the present day, I suppose, we hear, and devotees are very eager to hear about disciples of Srila Prabhupada and their interactions with Srila Prabhupada, because apart from being non-different from the Supreme Personality of Godhead as the Acharya, apart from that, as if that's a minor point, but Srila Prabhupada's personality was unique, endearing, unpredictable, delightful, and therefore there are so many stories of Srila Prabhupada, of devotees, the wonderful things that Srila Prabhupada did, and at the same time presenting himself, and in many ways thinking himself, as a very ordinary person. So really an exceptional person in so many ways, and he was able to win the hearts of so many disciples that could be imitated by, well, let's just be nice like Srila Prabhupada. But it's not imitable. What's the word? Imitable? Yeah, it must be imitable, I guess. Then, although there's no harm to try to be nice, whatever that word means, by like Srila Prabhupada, but at the same time, Srila Prabhupada wasn't just being nice with people. In fact, he was often very heavy with people, as Shruta Kirti Prabhu, who was one of his servants, said that Srila Prabhupada, when he shouted at you, you which he did, you'd feel like totally blown away. I can't remember exactly the words that Shruta Kirti Prabhu said. But then he also said, Shruta Kirti Prabhu said, but now I'd do anything to have the opportunity to have Srila Prabhupada shout at me again. Because now Srila Prabhupada isn't personally present in that way to shout at us, despite the claims of the Ritvik Vadis that Srila Prabhupada is personally here to guide us, and there's no difference. Often think to say to them, I don't meet them, but I would say then, as they're arguing among themselves, they can tell them, well, why are you arguing? Just go and ask Srila Prabhupada. It's just the same. He's here now. There's no difference. It's all the same. So just go and ask him. Well, there's a difference. the very fact that they argue among themselves, it disproves their whole philosophy, if you want to give it such an exalted title to their speculations. So, Srila Prabhupada, his personality certainly was exceptionally endearing, but that is not what identifies him or qualifies him as the Acharya. It's because he gave this spiritual knowledge. And that spiritual knowledge, well, what is it? What is the effect of that? Then you become a beautiful person, as was Srila Prabhupada. That should be the effect of this knowledge. But Srila Prabhupada systematically gave spiritual knowledge literally day and night. And as Harishari Prabhu often said, Srila Prabhupada was the living Bhagavatam. He lived what he spoke. And he was the personification of everything that the Bhagavatam spoke. Charu Prabhu, another of our godbrothers, he noted that he'd read Srila Prabhupada's books before he met Srila Prabhupada, and he often wondered about, well, when you meet an author, you read a book and you admire a book, and you wonder what the author's like, but you often think, well, the author, they're not going to be like you think they are. They may espouse high ideals in their book, but they're not going to be like that. But Charu Prabhu, when he actually met Srila Prabhupada, he saw that Srila Prabhupada was always speaking the same knowledge that he's given in his books and living it. And whether he's speaking to an audience of 100 or 1,000, or whether it was just to me alone in a room, he'd be speaking the same thing. And therefore, Charu Prabhu, he said, having realized that, he undertook to study Srila Prabhupada's books very, very carefully, understanding that this is what Srila Prabhupada has come to give. As Srila Prabhupada said, if you want to know me, read my books. So by the power of his personality and the process of Krishna consciousness that Srila Prabhupada gave, he was fully empowered by Krishna to give Krishna, Krishna Shaitoma, Krishna Dite Paro, Tomara Shakati Yachi. He was empowered by Krishna to give Krishna. Then many people became attracted to Krishna consciousness, but Srila Prabhupada emphasized again and again, it's not me. It's not specifically me that's important. It's Krishna that's important, and the knowledge and the process of Krishna consciousness that comes through the parampara. I'm here speaking Krishna consciousness, but there are my antecedents. Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasvati Thakur, Gorki Shodas Babri, Bhaktivinoda Thakur, Jagannatha. There's a whole sampradaya is there. I'm not speaking, it's not something that I've made up, or I am the chosen one, who I have got this, which no one else ever had before. I've come to save, well, Srila Prabhupada did come to save everyone, that's true, but but he emphasized this point, that this very ancient science of the Supreme, Saiva Yang Maya Teja Yoga Prokta Puratanaha, the very ancient science, it's not something new that someone discovers, it's the same knowledge. And the duty of the disciple is to receive that knowledge and to give it to others, and when he gives it to others in a formal and systematic way, then he's known as a guru. There are different kinds of gurus. Shiksha guru, Diksha guru, these are the two main categories. So one cannot simply set oneself up and speculate and claim to be a guru. In fact, that Srila Prabhupada emphasized that he comes in a parampara, that bolstered the devotee's faith in him more. If he had said, well, I just got this knowledge from some I woke up one day and I had all this knowledge, or I was struck by a lightning bolt, and then when I came to, I found I had all this spiritual realization. Foolish people or people who want something very cheap might be enamored by that, but the fact that Srila Prabhupada, even though his personality alone was enough to bring people to Krishna consciousness, he always emphasized that I'm receiving this knowledge into cyclic succession, and that helped to bolster the devotee's faith in him even more, and the humility of accepting that I am, as Srila Prabhupada said, just a peon. Peon is a term which means, in English, they say gopher. It means someone who just takes messages here and there. Something is written in one office and brought to another office. He delivers like a mailman, Srila Prabhupada said. I'm just like a mailman, but his humility in saying so, and also understanding that Srila Prabhupada, he is the representative of something much greater than himself, or that someone who is much greater than himself, who is Krishna, but that by representing representing Krishna, who is much greater than all of us, that by Krishna's desire, the Guru is to be considered as non-different from Krishna. Acharyam mang vijani annavamanyeta karihichetna marta buddha suyeta sarvadeva mayoguru. Although the Guru is constitutionally, in most cases, a jiva, not Bhagavan, the jiva is constitutionally subordinate to Krishna. The jiva is infinitesimal, and Bhagavan, Krishna, is infinite. But by Krishna's desire, the Guru is as good as God, to be seen as good as God. Not that he is God, but as good as God in this particular aspect. Not that he creates the universes and destroys them, but in the matter of transmitting transcendental knowledge, he is as good as Krishna. If we hear in the disciplic succession from a bona fide guru who doesn't speculate or change anything, then the message we hear, it's as good as Vivasvan hearing from Krishna, as good as Uddhava hearing from Krishna, as good as Arjuna hearing from Krishna. If we are as submissive and willing to receive the message as Vivasvan, Uddhava, Arjuna, and others. Whereas if someone who's a speculator, who just declares himself, now I'm a guru, now you listen to me, then they set up their disciples to also speculate. One who doesn't recognize an authority, the authority of the disciplic succession, then why should their disciples will also think, then why do I have to accept their authority? This happening in the Ritvik camp, that they have rejected the authority or the authority system that Srila Prabhupada gave, but then in their own camp, what happens then? The people come and then they think, well, They're supposed to be the leaders of the, and they were, well, why should we follow you? You're not following. Who are you following? You say you're following Prabhupada. Well, I'll also follow Prabhupada in the same way that you're doing, which is without anything in between. I can also follow directly Prabhupada. I don't need you. So it's like Protestantism, the Catholic Church, which Srila Prabhupada told us to study for its organization, not for its teachings in particular. But it's remained despite its, to put it euphemistically, its difficulties throughout. I mean, there's been much has been done and said within the Catholic Church, which clearly has nothing to do with the teachings of Jesus, but because that is at least the teachings of Jesus is at least officially the purpose of the church, and there's an authority structure, it's been able to survive all these years, whereas the Protestantism, which came up later, where as a protest, we don't accept all this garbage in the church. What is all this? These priests and useless people, Pope. We'll just die. We have the book and we have Jesus. That's all. And there are thousands and thousands of churches because there's no authority. It's just me and Jesus. And people talk to Jesus and he tells them what to do in their imagination. And that's what happens with gurus also, who just simply speculate, and then the disciple may also speculate. So Srila Prabhupada made this point that the guru is to be a follower, faithful follower. And on that basis, his disciples also, some of us are present here, myself, Prahladananda Maharaj, Smita Krishna Maharaj, we're also transmitting that knowledge and giving initiation. I know that my godbrothers here will not be upset if I say that we don't have that personality, that unique personality that Srila Prabhupada had, and that's very rare. But that is not actually the requirement to be a guru. You don't have to be exactly like Srila Prabhupada. And in fact, if we see the personalities of all the gurus in disciplic succession, they're all different people. That's our philosophy. But they all perform the same function of initiating and giving spiritual knowledge. And as much as they do that faithfully and follow, then those who follow them can link up with Srila Prabhupada and all the acharyas previously, all the way up to Krishna. That's how the principle works. It's a chain. If we remain a strong link in the parampara, in the chain, strong link means what we've heard, we repeat. What we're told to do, we do. If we do something different, then that will tend to create doubts in the minds of the disciple, or they think that, well, it's not. You see, the guru, he's such a great person. He's got some special realization by which he's following Srila Prabhupada, but you can't really see how he's following Srila Prabhupada or really understand by all his teachings. But he says he is. But he's got all these new techniques and all these different things. So that may create some doubt. And then it gives a license to the disciple to themselves also speculate. And then why to follow the guru? Because everyone has their own special realization, and the big thing becomes who's got the most special realizations. Whereas the real big thing is just to be a faithful transmitter of what one has heard. So, the parampara goes on. We're giving initiation today, and the disciples, they're also expected to hear and to follow the same thing. If they see that their guru is following Srila Prabhupada, then they also want to follow Srila Prabhupada. Srila Prabhupada, he stressed how he's following his own guru. And we are to follow him. Again, it doesn't mean that it's a complete stereotype, that we're in a straitjacket. But the basic principle is to be a faithful follower. So devotees who do that, they also disciples of Srila Prabhupada's disciples, they also get strength from the whole parampara, as coming through their own guru. When Krishna says, Acharyang mang vijani andava manyeta karhichit, you should know the Acharya to be me, as good as me, not disrespect him in any way. We may think, well, that applies to Srila Prabhupada, but Krishna doesn't say, well, that's only up to a certain point. And then the others, well, they're just, you know, just some kind of cardboard cutouts that they give initiation, but they're not really giving it. But no, that Krishna doesn't say that. In fact, this verse, Acharyang mang vijaniya, this is, Krishna is describing not the great world acharyas like Ramanuja Acharya, Madhva Acharya. He's describing the life of a brahmachari who lives in the forest ashram with a few disciples, with a grihastha guru. And Krishna says, you should know the guru to be as good as me. So that is the injunction of Shastra. One is to see like that. And as much as the guru is giving Krishna consciousness, he's giving the same process, then one should see the guru as good as Krishna, accept his instructions. The gurus, Vande Gurum, the very first words of Chaitanya Charitamrita, offering obeisance to all the gurus. Later on, Krishna as Kaviraj, he offers respects to the Shiksha gurus and the Mantra guru. So he recognizes a multiplicity of gurus. But that works in disciplic succession also. Those who are the disciples of Srila Prabhupada's disciples, by following with faith, those who are following Srila Prabhupada, they also, their faith increases as they experience the mercy of the parampara coming through, Krishna's mercy coming through, and they also generate faith in others. Spiritual leaders means good follower who's inspired to transmit the same thing to others. Within Krishna consciousness, there may become desires for recognition, name, fame, glory. But one who simply wants to serve sincerely, then he will attract others to also follow in that same selfless spirit, which is Krishna consciousness. But if a disciple doesn't like to follow the guru and nevertheless wants to set himself up as some big shot, then he might become a big shot within the organization, but he won't attract the mercy of Krishna. And others, they may follow him. If we emphasize, you have to follow the authority, well, that's there. The authority structure is there, but the authority is to be followed because they follow the authority. And as in the Catholic Church, as in any sampradaya, there's an authority structure, but the authority structure is to facilitate the giving and taking of spiritual knowledge, spiritual practice. So it's a great topic. It's a very big topic. It's a very difficult topic in as much as it's inconceivable. It's inconceivable. Why should the guru be thought of as good as God? It's inconceivable because his duty is to teach that we are not God. But his duty is also to teach that the guru, and he's taking the role of a guru, is as good as God. So it's a great topic, and it's difficult to understand, especially for people in the modern age, especially in the Western world where there's no culture of this. But even in India, it's also very difficult to understand because the institution of guruship has been so much misused. So although there's a general tendency among pious Hindus to accept a guru, but what exactly a guru means has become, the understanding of that has been much misused. Whereas in the West, the idea of having a guru and submitting to someone, Janme Prabhu say, not only this life, maybe with this life, and then I get my reward, and then at the end, and then I'm free to do whatever I like. But it's accepting initiation means to accept eternal bondage. Eternal bondage in to get free from material bondage. We submit ourselves to be eternally tied up at the lotus feet of the Acharya. And that's a very happy position. That is our constitutional position. Vaishnava Thakur, Tomar Kukur, Baleha Jana Homar. Let me be known as the dog of the Vaishnava, Bhaktivinoda Thakur sings. So it's a very difficult point to understand. And it becomes more difficult if we see that those who have accepted this superlative position that is much higher than any political position or the position of a wealthy businessman. It's much higher than that of a karmi, a jnani, a yogi, of Lord Brahma. That the position of a guru is the biggest position of all, and it becomes very difficult to understand when it's seen that some gurus they abuse that position or they fall from that position. But nevertheless, despite the discrepancies, what Krishna has given, what he has taught, as we have received in disciplic succession, we have to go on with it. We have no choice but to do so. And if we are fortunate, Brahmanda Brahmite Kono Bhagavan Jeev Guru Krishna Prasade Pai Bhakti Lata Bij, if we are fortunate enough to come to the lotus feet of a bona fide guru, then all our fortune becomes open. If we're not so fortunate, well, that's a very great misfortune. So we have to pray to Krishna. By the mercy of Krishna, one gets a guru. By the mercy of guru, one gets Krishna. So we have to pray to Krishna to guide us, and not just to accept the bona fide guru. In our present situation, bona fide guru within ISKCON means bona fide follower of Srila Prabhupada. It's a very simple point to understand. It's not, but the application of it may bring up so many different doubts. But the principle is simple, and we can pray to Krishna to keep us on the path following the disciplic succession, which takes us all the way to Krishna. It's a chain. We're drowning in the ocean of material existence. That chain comes down. Grab the chain. Hold on. And we'll be pulled up out of this ocean of material existence up to the spiritual world. Hare Krishna. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. There should be prasadam distribution now. Those who are going to be initiated should fast until after the initiation ceremony. Hare Krishna.